Dr. Rohit Shetty.
Thank you, sir. My talk is on how do you predict what is going to happen when you do a surgery, when you are planning a new techniques, or you're trying to innovate in your procedures. It's always the problem when there is a slide. These are my financial interests. Why do you need prediction? Is a question which we all need to ask, because we all love to see how and what would happen to our procedures, what we plan. Oops. I take a few minutes on this article. This was published in Cell last year, 2017. This is by a very renowned healthcare professional, but his views are taken up very seriously by the US government. He's advisor to last three presidents in US, the Ali, Trokamani, and Group. What he says is, he calls it as a high definition medicine, and he says this is not ophthalmology, this could be anything, any branch of medicine we follow. He says this next war on disease is going to be fought on DNA, understanding the physiological and environmental monitoring, and advanced imaging, and most importantly, it's your behavioral tracking, because all these factors, in some form or the other, is actually affecting your disease and outcome, and that is what is very important. So what he means actually is, your human body is composed of your mind, your genes, your protein structures, the place where you work, and how the genetic factors influence your virus, your bacteria, and how well you keep yourself fit, and all those factors, you need a baseline. And that's what Dr. Vaishali also explained. You're taking a baseline, and then you use a baseline, and you see what is the deviation from your baseline. Once you deviate from your baseline, the machine starts understanding how you're going to be deviated based on all these factors. So when you talk about any predicting models, you have to have each and every component into your system. So if one component is missing, that means you have lost that component and your prediction value drops down by significantly. So if I just concentrate on refractive surgery, there is a lot of data out there about what can predict, but this paper also says that we do not know. That means virtually every single predicting model says that, well, we need more data to analyze. So that's how they conclude. So why is need a prediction is a seemingly normal looking topography. One goes into nectasia, other one goes into a normal procedure. If you look at this, this should not go into this. We would assume that this probably should be here. I mean, we keep wondering what really happens. So that is the real need why we need a prediction. That's why we need a tracking. The one of the first things we need to do is we do not have technologies. That's why deviating from the real hardcore technology to a virtual technology, which is more mathematically driven, we do not have a technology which can tell us what's happening. So that's why we need to take help of some mathematics, and that's what's called as the finite element modeling. So it is a software-driven thing where you start looking, taking a cornea, your own cornea from the topography, and start playing around and trying to use like a mesh model where you're trying to stretch and see what really happens. So what really happens in our study is that at some point of time, you use all the data given up and you create a mesh model where you have your stretched and strained. And then you have how much does the LASIK actually correct? This is data is available in every machine. You add everything, then you get what is going to happen to your procedure when you do it. That's the predicting model. I mean, it's a little complex for a 10-minute talk to explain this slide. This slide itself can go on for an hour because it is hardcore mathematics, and it's quite interesting if somebody is interested. So how do we use this knowledge and where do we use this is something we need to see. This work was done by William Dupes and the colleague of mine who works with me, Dr. Abhijit Roy, which every SMILE user uses this, about how it is actually changing the strength of the cornea. It was not done on patients. The SMILE uses it quite frequently. It was done on a modeling only. So this is what I just want to see the power of this modeling. So let's look at this 2.5 diopters and not put a topography. You can have a normal topography or a suspicious topography out here. Your big challenge is will this go into an ectasia or how much weakness it causes. So what we did was we had to take this kind of a topographies in our study, around 25 patients in each group who underwent different procedures. So what we did was we know exactly after surgery, we know the corneal biomechanics can be measured. But we wanted to know if our artificial intelligence-based software can actually predict the final outcome. So let's look at PRK. The dotted lines are simulation. This is the pre-op, and this is pre-op green color, and the black was what happens post-op. So in PRK, there's not much of a change in your biomechanics. It's more or less same. Now let's look at the dotted lines. What really happens, what we predicted would happen, it's quite close. Is saying that you could actually predict the changes happening in your procedure. Now the second one was smile. This is what happened post smile, and this is what the machine predicted. It was again close. That means if you make the machine robust, it can actually predict how much of weakness it causes. LASIK was a little different because it had a huge biomechanical change, but however, the modeling which predicted that this is exact amount of change is what predicted right. So at one step, as even though this is a very pilot study, it just tells us that there is a huge role of these procedures. Now we wanted to do the second question. When you do a flap or a cap in a smile procedure, how much does it contribute to the biomechanical weakness? Because many people say that it's just not the flap, it is the laser also. So what we did in this experiment was, we did the flap, we did the cap of the smile, but we did not do the procedure. We just cut the flap. Ethics committee gave us approval for 4 hours. They said, you can wait for 4 hours, do a biomechanical assessment, and then do the surgery. So what we were trying to ask is, can a cap or a flap, when you do, how much does that contribute? So this is a flap and cap experiment. I explained what we do, so I can just skip this. We waited for 4 hours, and then we did the So what we found was, this was pre-op strength of the cornea. Imagine this is KC constant and mean. After the flap, you had a reduction of your corneal biomechanics. And after the LASIK, the reduction was very less compared to just the flap. So what did it tell us? That it predicted that just cutting the cornea without doing any refractive error drops down your biomechanics significant. Now what happens in your lace, in your smile, it also drops down, but the drop is not as much as your flap. So a simple experiment which proves that what we know, that you know, the flap or the cap, but it also proves how much does it change. But the PRK was different, but it was not possible to include PRK in this group because we can't do a epithelial removal and then do a biomechanical testing. So you can even predict how much thickness of flap you can take based on the intraocular pressure, how much it would change. So there are a lot of ways of predicting which can do. The last few slides of mine is the future. How do you connect everything? Because to get a disease, you have to have a disease, you have to have a genetic background and your host response. Otherwise, only if you have only two factors out of three, all you're going to get it only subclinical disease. And subclinical diseases are always very difficult because they are the outliers. They don't, but when you have all the three things together, that's when you have a disease and you need multiple other stuff. So how do we apply this in our practice? Is if you go only mathematically, every patient should have got an ectasia here because that amount of weakness is caused by your LASIK. But why they don't do it is because there are other factors which play important role. Your hormones, your nerves, your allergies, your inflammation. So one of the big reasons why a lot of artificial intelligence and mathematical modeling fail is you only take one arm of it. You either take a mathematics or you take a cell biology. The whole future is if you include everything, add everything together, only then probably any model will work, including the model which I just suggested. Because when you look at this one case, this was a case of when I developed a smile-related ectasia. I've shown it in the past also. We did not discard this lenticule. We preserve most of our stuff because it will help us to understand what really happens. It was done in 2015, but this patient developed ectasia 2017. This was preserved then in one of the cryopreserved stuff. So it was like a, you know, a bank locker. In 2017, we had this ectasia. So we went back to the same biorepository, took out that patient's lenticule, and we processed it. Why we need to do it is because the patient was in normal topography. There was no problem in our eyes. Each and everything which we discard, epithelium, lenticule, is like a pen drive. You plug it in into a right system. It gives you a lot of data, and that data can really change the way we look at it. And this patient, for some reason, had a problem in the lysyl oxidase. Lysyl oxidase are endogenous cross-linkers. If you don't have lysyl oxidase, the collagen cross-linking does not occur. So that is one of the reasons why it was important. And this is the first time ever we have found that there is something like this in an ectasia case. And this modeling for this patient failed because it showed that she will not develop an ectasia. The modeling failed because I used only mathematics for her. But there is a huge component of cell biology which we have never looked at. So what is the future is include mathematics, include newer dimension, include all that we know from a disease more and more. You include all the three things, the biomarkers, imaging, genetics, and then you plug it into your system, and then you get what you want. And that is the real future of a predicting model. Till that time, we just can hope and pray that whatever you're getting, you're reaching somewhere. Thank you.